Very warm greetings to everyone and welcome to the first webinar of the 2022 TWAS Awards Series. This first webinar will focus on agricultural sciences, medical sciences, and biology. My name is Max Paoli, the TWAS program coordinator, and I will be facilitating this session. I will do my best for us to keep to time, although I must regret that we're starting slightly later than we planned because of some issues in reaching out one of the speakers, but we are working on that. And I would like to ask you to make sure that you identify the Q&A button on your screen. That is the place where we ask you please to submit any questions you might have, scientific questions on after the lectures. Each lecture will be followed by a short Q&A. Once the presentation is over, the chair of the session will deliver your questions from the Q&A to the winner. I am now honored to introduce TWAS President, Professor Mohamed Hassan, who will officially open today's webinar via a recorded video to welcome you to this event. Professor Hassan, the floor is yours.
Dear TWAS fellows and affiliates, dear colleagues and participants, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me immense pleasure and honor to welcome you all to the second TWAS Awards webinar series. Allow me to extend a special warm welcome to our awardees as they, their work and their achievements are the focus of this webinar series. As you all know by now, recognizing and rewarding excellence in science is an essential part of TWAS mission. And our recognition and support to the most outstanding scientists working and living in developing countries give the awardees greater national, regional, and global visibility. Building upon the success of the first TWAS Awards webinar series held last year, we decided to continue honoring scientific achievements in this format and to use it once more to pave the way to TWAS 16th General Conference that will also be held online from 21st to 24 November, and which will be organized by TWAS Secretariat in conjunction with the Yijiang University in China. As we all have learned in the past 2 years, the online format allows for a much broader and diverse participation from all over the world. So while we had to adapt to circumstances that were beyond our control, we have been cherishing the benefits that arose from those challenges. And to gather such an outstanding community of scientists to attend the webinars is definitely one of them. The series is an opportunity for TWAS award winners to deliver presentations showcasing their accomplishments and respond to questions from the webinar's participants. This second webinar series will highlight the achievements of the winners of TWAS Awards for the years 2022, 2021, and 2020. The series will involve 19 scientists and will consist of 5 webinars clustered by thematic areas. As the last year, each webinar will feature 3 to 5 awardees, and it will be chaired by a distinguished TWAS fellow and moderated by a staff member of TWAS. Finally, I wish to congratulate all awardees who in this webinar series are presenting their remarkable contributions to the advancement of science, technology, and innovation. It is my pleasure now to declare open the second webinar series of TWAS Awards and give the floor to today's moderator and chair. Thank you and best wishes for a successful and enjoyable webinar.
I thank wholeheartedly Professor Hassan for his words. And now I'm honored and privileged to introduce a distinguished chairperson for today, Professor Quarisha Abdul Karim. Professor Abdul Karim is a 2015 TWAS Fellow, Associate Scientific Director of the Center for the AIDS Program of Research in South Africa, also known as CAPRISA, abbreviated as CAPRISA. Professor Abdul Karim will now introduce today's 4 speakers. I say 4 because although we planned for 5, for health reasons, sadly, we will not have our 5th winner. Thank you. Over to you, Professor Abdul Karim. Professor Abdul Karim, the floor is yours. Can you hear me?
Thank you very much, Paulo, and greetings, everyone. It gives me great pleasure, and it's a real honor and privilege to be part of this awards ceremony this afternoon, where we honor distinguished scientists who've made remarkable contributions in agricultural sciences and also in the medical sciences, in addition to a special award. So as you know, the TWAS Awards are given out every 2 years. And there are 9 such fields of science that are recognized. And today we are recognizing the agricultural sciences and the medical sciences. In addition, we have the annual TWAS Abdul Karim Award in Biological Sciences that was initiated in 2017. And this particular award, the TWAS Abdul Karim Award, is funded from an award I received as a L'Oreal UNESCO laureate in 2016. And it was specifically developed to honor women scientists in low-income African countries for their achievements in biological sciences. Now, we know that the Agricultural Science Award for 2020 is being awarded to Daoxin Chi for his fundamental contribution to the understanding of the sensing mechanism in plants, in particular, how jasmonate and strigolactone regulate plants' defense and development. Our co-winners for the 2020 TWAS Awards in Medical Sciences is Hugo Luján for his studies on the molecular mechanisms of parasite adaptation and differentiation. And he shares this Medical Science Award with Dr. Ewei Song for his contribution to the understanding of the role of tumor plasticity in tumor microenvironment therapies. And the winner of the 2021 TWAS Abdul Karim Award in Biology is Dabitwa Chinaba for her contribution in the field of inflammatory cytokine responses in health and disease. And what we will do is we will hear in turn from each of the award winners a synopsis of their work. And after each presentation, there will be an opportunity for Q&A. So let's go right in then to our winner of the 2022 TWAS Award in Agricultural Sciences. Dr. Daoxin Shi is a professor at Tsinghua University in Beijing, China, an academician of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. He serves as the Vice Chancellor of the Academic Committee of Tsinghua University, Chairman of the Scientific Ethics Committee, and is Deputy Director of the Chinese National Biosafety Committee for Agricultural Genetically Modified Organisms. And we'll now listen to Dr. Daoxin's presentation. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Good evening, good morning, or probably good afternoon. Very nice to meet you online. My name is Daoxin Xie. I'm from School of Life Science, Tsinghua University, Beijing, China. I previously worked in United Kingdom as a postdoctor or research fellow. I then worked in Singapore as a principal investigator or senior scientist. In year 2006, I moved to Tsinghua University. It is my great honor to accept the award in agricultural sciences. Before my talk, I would like to express many thanks to the World Academy of Sciences. Thank you. We are interested in plant hormone perception and signal transduction. We focused on two hormones, jasmine and streptolactone. Jasmine is a key plant hormone that regulates plant defense and development. Jasmine regulates diverse biotic and abiotic stresses, including plant defense against pathogen infection, insect attack, drought tolerance. Jasmine also regulates diverse plant development response, including fertility, seed development, leaf senescence. In the first part of my talk, I would like to share with you the research progress in jasmine field. I would like to address three scientific questions. The first question is how plants activate GA biosynthesis up on insect attack. We identified a key gene called JAV1, which is required for plant defense against insects and pathogen. We first found the JAV1 form a complex with other proteins we named as JJW complex to binding to the promoter of GA biosynthesis genes represses the expression of those genes, resulting in the low level of jasmate in health plants. After an insect attack, those complex was phosphorylated and then degraded through 26S proteasome. Then the GA biosynthesis gene will be activated, the jasmate will accumulate. The next question we would like to ask is how plant cell perceive the GA signal. I previously isolated the COIN1 gene, which is essential for GA-regulated plant defense and fertility when I was a postdoc in University of East Anglia. After I moved to Singapore to set up my own lab, we continue to demonstrate that the COIN1 protein form SCF complex that is required for all the GA-regulated plant response. In year 2006, I moved to Tsinghua University. We continue to demonstrate that the COIN1 protein serves as a receptor of jasmate, and the jasmate perception mechanism is conserved in different plant species, including rice, Allodopsis, and rubber tree. The third question is related to GA signal transduction. We would like to address how a single molecule jasmate can regulate diverse plant response, including fertility, anthocyanin production, trichome formation, leaf senescence, seed side control, plant defense against insects and pathogens. What is the mechanism? We used JAS protein as a bed to screening Allodopsis library in East 2 hybrid system to identify JAS interacting proteins. We have identified several interaction proteins, including MIP2124 and MIG2345. We then use genetic strategy to verify the biological function for different transcription factors. For example, here we identified the mutants for MIP2124. We demonstrated that those transcription factors is essential for plant fertility. We uncovered the molecular basis for GA regulated plant male fertility. So JAS protein will interact and repress the expression of MIP transcription factor. During the flower stage, jasmate molecules will be rapidly accumulated in plant cell, in flower, then perceived by its receptor COIN1. The JAS repressor will be ubiquitinized, degraded through 26S proteasome. After that, the transcription factor MIP will be activated to mediate the expression of the L gene responsible for plant male fertility. Use the similar strategies, we further demonstrate transcription factor MIP2, MIP3, MIP4, and MIP5 function redundant regulator plant fertility, seminar strategies are used to uncover other transcription factor or transcription complex which regulate GA-mediated anthocyanin production, trichome development, plant defense against pathogen and insects, leaf senescence. We also uncover the mechanism for interaction between jasminate and acinin to regulate plant defense and development, and the interaction between jasminate and gibberellin to regulate trichome formation, anthocyanin production, and plant fertility. In the second part of my talk, I will briefly introduce the work we've done in Strigalactam area. Strigalactam is a new hormone that regulates plant branching, growth of parasitic weeds. We know parasitic weeds will cause agricultural disaster with the loss of billions of dollars every year in the world. Strigalactam also regulates plant communication with AM fungi. AM fungi is very important for plant growth in nature. They will help plants to take nutrition from the soil. We have set up a genetic screening system to identify the mutants deficient in Strigalactam singling. Using comprehensive strategies, we have demonstrated that the D14 protein is a receptor for Strigalactam. The D14 protein has two functions, as an enzyme and as a receptor. D14 protein as an enzyme hydrolyzes Strigalactam into a lower active molecules. As a receptor, D14 protein covalently interact with Strigalactam lower active molecules and undergoes the open to closed change, which is suitable for binding with downstream components to activate the Strigalactam responses. The Strigalactam perception mechanism uncovered in Allodopsis is also conserved in rice, in root parasitic weeds. I just very briefly mentioned the research progress we have made in Strigalactam field. I'm sorry I don't have time to show experimental details. I also don't have time to discuss our recent progress in Strigalactam field. Here, I just briefly summarize my talk. We demonstrated that D40 protein serves as a receptor for Strigalactam, and the Strigalactam perception mechanism is conserved in different plant species including the rice, allotopsis, and weeds. In the first part of my talk, I have briefly mentioned our work in adjustment accumulation, perception, and signaling transduction. So in response to biotic or abiotic stress or development cue, adjustment will be quickly accumulated in plant cell and perceived by its receptor CoI1 protein, which will recruit the downstream repressor JAS protein for ubiquitination and degradation in 26 proteasome. After the degradation of JAS protein, the downstream transcription factor will be activated to mediate diverse plant response, including fertility, anthocyanin production, trichin formation, defense against the insects and the pathogens. Detailed information about the results I mentioned in my talk can be found in those publications. I will stop here to take your question. Thank you very much. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Chi, for providing that excellent overview of very complex science that, and I'm so pleased that you've shared some of the citations that you've used. We can undoubtedly see the high impact publications they've appeared in, and for your fundamental contributions to our understanding of the molecular mechanisms underlying a plant hormone action. In the brief time, you've also shared with us how you uncovered the receptor and signal transduction mechanism of the plant defense hormone, jasmonate, and also looking at the non-canonical perception mechanism for the branching hormone, stridolactone. And I always thought I knew how all these complex words, but I've learned a whole lot of new words as well. Congratulations again on being the recipient and the winner of the 2022 TWAS Award in Agricultural Sciences. I think your presentation and the citation you've received adequately cover the groundbreaking contributions you've made. I don't see any. Okay, so it's part of this hybrid and multiple things. There's a question. We have two questions for you. So let's start with the first one, which is the high level of jasmonate would promote plant's defense but inhibit plant growth. How do you use jasmonate-related genes in molecular breeding of crops? So deal with that, and then I'll go through the second question.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So the first question is, jasmonate can enhance plant defense, but inhibit plant growth. Then in agriculture or in the molecular breeding of crop plants, how can we use the information of jasmonate signaling or biosynthesis to engineer the plants? Okay, so I just briefly mentioned in my talk, we have identified a complex called the JJW complex, which consists of three proteins, JAV1, WOC51. So we have mutated the JAV1 or WOC51. We find the mutants is resistant to insect attack, also resistant to pathogen infection, but the development of the plants is not affected. So we measured the jasmine level. So in the mutants, without insect attack, that means in health plants, the jasmine level remains in a low level, similar to wild type plants. However, after an insect attack or pest infection, the jasmine contents or jasmine level will quickly accumulate in the mutants, in JAV1 mutants or double mutants of JAV1, WOC51. So the jasmine level will be very high after an insect attack. So in this way, if we can use gene editing or CRISPR-Cas9 to lock down or mutate the homologs of JAV1, WOC51 in crop plants, for example, in rice, then those plants should be without pathogen or insect attack. The growth and development is normal as a wild type. So after an insect attack, the DNA level will quickly accumulate to activate the DNA adjustment, the single transduction to defense against the insects and the pathogen. And so I think this is the one way. Previously, there are some work to overexpress some G biosynthesis genes. There seems increase the G level, but has a little bit of inhibition on growth or development of the plants. So I think the best way to find the downstream transcription factor, which is specifically for plant defense, but will not affect plant development or plant growth. This is the best way to do it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And just being mindful of time, if you could be brief in responding to the second question, which relates to strigalactone. And the question is, in addition to regulating shoot branching of plants and seed germination of parasitic weeds, strigalactone can also be perceived by AM fungi to regulate symbiosis. The question is, what is the perception mechanism for strigalactone in AM fungi? And will AM fungi have similar perception mechanisms with plant and parasitic weeds? Thank you.
Thank you. Quick answer is we don't know because they don't have any publication about the strigalactone perception in AM fungi. We are working on this based on the current information from genome sequence or transcription profile of the AM fungi. It seems that the perception mechanism of strigalactone in AM fungi is different from that in rice, in rice allodopsis and parasitic woods, because there's no strong homologs of the receptor D14 in the AM fungi. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Chi, and we all look forward to hearing the outcomes from some of your ongoing research. I think you're at a cusp of a very exciting stage in terms of unraveling even further some of these molecular mechanisms underlying these plant hormones, and we look forward to that. Okay, so we'll now move on to the first of the medical science presentations, and we'll hear first from Professor Hugo Luján, who is a full professor of biochemistry at the School of Medicine in the Catholic University of Cordoba in Argentina, and he's also the head of the Center for Immunology and Infectious Diseases
of the National Scientific and Technical Research Council, also referred to as CD-CONICHE. And Professor Luján, congratulations on your being recognized for your work and decades of research on parasite adaptation and differentiation. We look forward to hearing an overview of your work and your key contributions. And from there, we'll then move to a Q&A session. So congratulations and welcome. And we look forward to your feedback.
Thank you very much to you. Thanks. I first want to apologize by slightly changing the focus of my presentation today from antigenic variation in Giardia and other parasitic protozoan to a more general approach that we have been using in the last years in order to move from the basic research to more applied science, and always using Giardia as a model organism in order to try to find answers to questions that are more difficult to respond and to analyze using more complex cells. Giardia is considered one of the earliest branches in eukaryotes, and for that reason, we can use this simple microorganism to better understand basic molecular and fundamental cellular processes. Just to give a brief introduction to Giardia. Giardia is a protozoan microorganism. They have this happy face to which everybody remember from the parasitology textbook. We can say that Giardia is perhaps the only microorganism that can inhabit in the upper small intestine of many vertebrates. Giardia is transmitted by contaminated water or food, and therefore is more prevalent in developing countries. To survive outside the intestine, these Giardia trophozoa differentiate into seeds, which are environmental resistant and can remain viable for years outside the host intestine. However, the basic question here is, how can Giardia survive in the hostile environment of the upper small intestine? The upper small intestine is where digestion takes place for further absorption of nutrients by the body. But how can Giardia colonize the upper small intestine without being digested, like many other components entering the gastrointestinal tract? And we found many years ago, and this is a particular historic picture taken by Paolo Pimenta at the NIH in the USA, that using a monoclonal antibody directed to an antigen called variant-specific surface antigen, or VSPs, and when this antibody was labeled with gold particles, we could observe that the entire surface of the trophozoite, including the ventral disc and the flagella, are completely covered by a thick coat of these proteins that may protect the parasite for digestion within the small intestine. But at the same time, these BSP are involved in the process of antigenic variation. As you can see here, five trophozoites, but only one can be labeled with a specific monoclonal to a member of this family of BSPs. The exchange of these BSP for another make the parasite able to evade the host immune response and producing chronic and recovering infections. These VSP are type 1 membrane proteins comprising highly viable extracellular domain, highly conserved cytoplasmic tail comprising only 5 amino acids and a unique transmembrane domain, which is also very conserved among all members of this family of cysteine-rich proteins. The amount of cysteine in the ectodomain varies from 12 to 17% in cysteine, which means it is very different to any other non-protein. And these cysteine are mostly present as cysteine XX cysteine motifs. These multiple motifs are able to bind xyron and zinc, making this protein highly resistant to proteolytic digestion, but also highly immunogenic, inducing a very strong cellular and humoral immune response. And like I said before, from a repertoire of approximately 140 VSP coding genes present in the Jardia genome, only one VSP is expressed on the surface of individual cells in a given point in time. And switching in expression produces this process of antigenic variation. So we demonstrated many years ago that the selection of the VSP that is going to be expressed on the parasite surface is controlled by a mechanism similar to RNA interference. And key molecules of this pathway, like RNA polymerase and dicer, are key players in this process. And silencing of these two key enzymes of the RNA interference pathway produce trophosphore expressing the entire repertoire of VSP on their surface. So at the time, we thought that we can use these transgenic cells for vaccination against Jardia, but as you may think, Jardia is a pathogenic microorganism and cannot be used as a vaccine. So we generated another monoclonal antibody to this 5 amino acid concerned cytoplasmic tail of the VSP, and were able to purify the full cocktail of VSP from these transgenic cells in order to generate a vaccine. And when we tested that vaccine, we found that that the disruption of antigenic variation is essential for effective production of parasitic vaccine, in particular to this microorganism that undergoes antigenic variation. So, because Jardia colonized the upper small intestine, we thought that if we use this vaccine by the oral route instead of by injection, we can get a similar response. And in fact, when we use this oral vaccine, including the entire repertoire of potential Jardia surface antigens, the animal model of Jardiasis, the gerbil, were protected from subsequent Jardia infections. But remarkable, this oral vaccine was administered without the presence of any adjuvant. And so the animals were protected and never presented any sign of the disease. We moved forward and vaccinated domestic animals, dogs and cats. We are known to transmit Jardia to humans. And we found that this vaccine not only prevented Jardia infection in animals in the lab and alleviate the sign of Jardiasis on those animals already infected with this parasite, but also when we tested this vaccine in a by vaccinating dogs and cats in a shantytown in a place near to my lab, we found that just by vaccination of the animals, the transmission to human was reduced, in first indicating the zoonotic potential of Jardia, but also that vaccinated animals prevented infection of the children of that plague. And we thought at the time, can we use the Jardia VSP to protect an adjuvant another antigens for oral administration? And so we just knew that the first successful vaccine were live attenuated or heat inactivated pathogens. I mean, particle-based formulations, which were always more effective than soluble antigens. Many things have changed during the last 2 years during the pandemic regarding vaccines. But in our case, we still believe that this particle-based formulation are better than soluble antigens. And for that, we get in touch with our investigator in France, Dr. David Tasman, who was working on virus-like particles for the development of a vaccine against human hepatitis. And these particles make up a different component of several viruses, but they can be easy in same assembly in the lab and escalate to for the industrial production of them. And we decided why not to pseudotype to decorate these particles with the Jardia BSP to make this particle able to be administered orally instead of be injected. We tested this platform originally with antigen of influenza virus, and we found that, among many other things, that oral vaccination with this virus-like particles containing a virus-like particle containing the Jardia BSP on the surface with highly effective in protecting the animals from death caused by the virus challenge, whereas the controls in any of the controls, many others animals died during the experiment. That showed that BSP, pseudotype BSP, are effective also at distal sites. So because we vaccinated orally, but we challenged the animals intranasally. So what the mucosal immunity generated in the gut, it also recapitulates on the respiratory tract. Also, we tested if what happened in those vaccinated animals when we injected tumor cells expressing the vaccinal antigen, hemagglutinin in this case. And we saw that only when during oral vaccination with these virus-like particles containing the vaccinal antigen and pseudotype with the Jardia BSP, the development of tumors was almost avoided as compared with the control in which large tumors were generated, which also may suggest that this platform of BSP, pseudotype BSP, may be useful as anti-cancer vaccine due to the generation of a strong cytotoxic T-cell response. So we developed a platform of nanojardias covering vaccinal antigens for oral administration. And it was this work was published in 2019, showing that these particles, pseudotype with a protozoan surface antigen, are highly efficient for induction of a strong mucosal immunity. This platform highlights the importance of the upper small intestine as a potent target for effective vaccination, both at the mucosal level and the systemic level, but also may play an important role in battling vaccine refusal, something that we have been hearing during the last 2 years very, very much. Not only about aversion to needle or discomfort to metal and chemical based and adjuvant, but also by many other conspiratory theories. Just at the time we were hit by the pandemic. And we decided to move from Jardia to influenza and now to SARS-CoV-2. And we performed similar kind of experiment in using the Hamster model of COVID-19, using particles, including stabilized spike proteins, and together with the membrane protein, which assembly very, very easily are produced and in high amounts. And we were able to demonstrate that this vaccine platform not only was able to induce a strong mucosal immunity, in particular by a strong generation of secretory immunoglobulin A, specific to the viral antigens in all mucosas of the body, but also protected this animal from infection instead of being only effective against severe disease. And just to finish, as many people on my lab, from the lab of Dr. David Kaufman and Dr. Tim Sporwasser, and also the financial support of many institutions, not only from Argentina, but also from Europe. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Luján, for sharing with us the series of experiments that help unravel how parasitic protozoa adapt to and adjust and survive under different environmental conditions, the studies that helped us understand intercellular protein trafficking and cyst wall formation in intestinal parasites and the mechanisms for antigenic variation that allow the parasites to evade host immune responses, producing chronic and or recurrent infections. Now, I see there's a question for you, which is, can the findings you've made in Giardia be extrapolated to other parasites undergoing antigenic variation? And the second question, which I'll also share with you now, is can these oral vaccine formulations be used to prevent infections by other pathogens?
Okay, thanks. The first question is, every pathogenic microorganism that undergoes antigenic variation uses different mechanism to exchange the antigen on the surface. However, we have found and we have ready for publication very exciting results showing that many parasites share common ways of get rid of the former antigen to replace it for another one. And you will soon see the papers with the result that we have in that regard. So there are differences, but also are very common ways for the parasites to exchange the surface antigen in order to survive within the host. And regarding the second question, if we can use different antigens in our vaccine, oral vaccine platform, exactly, yes, we can. We can use any kind of antigen. We are collaborating now with many different groups around the world, trying to include inside this particle or on the surface of these particles, antigen not only of viral origin, but also neoantigens from cancer cells, and bacterial antigens in order to combat all diseases for which we don't have a vaccine at the moment.
Thank you so much. And we really look forward to seeing those publications and your ongoing work to advance our understanding of parasitic infections and how we can manage those better. So we'll move on now to Professor Elway Song, the co-winner of the 2022 TWAS Award in Medical Sciences. Professor Song is professor in breast surgery and president of the Sun Yat-sen Memorial Hospital at the Sun Yat-sen University in Guangzhou, China. He's also a member of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. Congratulations, Professor Song, and we look forward to hearing more about your contributions and enhancing our understanding of the role of tumor plasticity in tumor microenvironment therapies.
Dear colleagues, dear friends, first of all, I would like to thank the organizer for the invitation. And it is my great honor to attend the TWAS webinar. And today I'm going to propose a concept that is going to be published in Trends in Immunology, Effector Immune Cell Deployment, and how EICD influence immunotyping and also immunotherapies in clinics. And I'm going to talk about EICD in tumor immunotyping, and also we'll look at whether there are opportunities for therapy to enhance EICD in cancer patients. As we all know, immunoediting is very important for tumor development. And we can divide it into three stages. At the first stage, host immunity can constrain tumor growth. We call this an immunoemulation. At the second stage, host immunity is at balance with tumor growth. We call it an immune equilibrium. And at the last stage, the tumor can escape from host immune attack and also to launch immune suppression to the host. We call this an immune escape. And how to develop immunotherapy based on these mechanisms, for example, for breast cancer, we have adoptive T cell therapy, tumor vaccine, and immune checkpoint blockage. Recently, immune checkpoint blockage is very effective to improve patient survivals in melanoma and also in other solid tumors. For example, for breast cancer and metastatic triple negative breast cancer, a monotherapy of PD-1 blockage, which is a very important checkpoint, we can see that PD-1 blockage can improve the ORR of breast cancer patients, especially in those with PD-L1 positive. Also, combine PD-L1 blockade with chemotherapy for advanced triple negative breast cancer can improve survival for the patients in PD-L1 positive breast cancer. And what influences the effect of immune checkpoint blockade is the infiltration of tumor antigen-specific lymphocytes. Because we know that only those T cells that recognize the tumor antigens and those are activated can kill tumor cells. And when these cells become allergic, immune checkpoint blockade can reactivate the tumor antigen specific T cells and to kill tumor cells. So we should look at tumor antigen specific lymphocytes to determine whether the patient is suitable for ICB blockade or not. But nowadays, we usually define hot and cold tumor only by the infiltration of immune cells or T cells in the tumors. Usually, we divide the tumors into three different types. Immune desert means that we can rarely find any immune cells in the tumor. And immune excluded means that the T cells or immune cells are excluded outside the tumor. And when immune cells infiltrate into the tumor, we call it an inflamed tumor, which is the hot tumor, as we usually call. However, it is not suitable to just look at immune cell infiltration in the tumor, because our studies show that the infiltration of anti-tumor T cells, for example, Th1 or CTLs, correlates with better survival of the breast cancer patients. However, infiltration level of the immunosuppressive regulatory T cells or Th2 T cells or even naive CD4 T cells correlates with poor survival for the breast cancer patients. And also, our unpublished study show that there is a subset of CD8 T cells, resident memory T cells, and they can be found in pre-metastatic niche of the lungs and also in the tumor draining lymph node. cells is associated with improved lung metastatic-free survival in breast cancer patients. And these T cells are actually tumor antigen specific, and they can kill breast cancer cells very efficiently. So it is important to look at those effector immune cells in the microenvironment of the tumor to define whether the tumor is a hot one or a cold one. So we propose the concept effector immune cell deployment. And these effector immune cells actually include adaptive T cells, which recognize tumor antigen, and also innate immune cells like NK cells, which are activated. And EICD could be a more accurate concept instead of just looking at immune cells or T cells to define a cold or hot tumor. And whether there are therapeutic opportunities to enhance effector immune cell deployment in cancer patients, we first investigate mechanisms that influence EICD. We found that there's a membrane-associated protein, RGS1, which couples with chemokine receptors. It can inhibit the recruitment of anti-tumor T cells into the tumor. Also, when the tumor antigen-specific T cells are recruited into the tumor, they are sensitive to undergo apoptosis. We call this an activation-induced cell death. And activation-induced cell death of T cells is controlled by NF-kappa B signaling, a long, long-running RNA and killer that coupled with the signaling pathway, actually it mediates the sensitivity of AICD in tumor antigen-specific T cells. Also, the T cells in the tumor stroma should be reactivated to kill tumor cells. And upon chemotherapy, we found that a tertiary or secondary lymphoid structure are formed in the tumor. And in this structure, we can identify ICOS ligand expression in the B cells. And these subset of B cells actually they can activate T cell immunity in the tumor. But tumor cells can express CD55, which can inhibit ICOS ligand expression in the B cells, and then impairs anti-tumor T cell immunity. Also, naive CD4 T cells can be recruited to the tumor by CCL18, a macrophage chemokine. But these naive CD4 T cells are turned into Tregs in the microenvironment of breast cancer. And the Tregs then form a kind of immunosuppressive microenvironment in breast cancer. Also, inflammation is observed after chemotherapy. And usually this inflammation is associated with macrophages. We found that the M1 macrophages switched by chemotherapy from M2 macrophages can activate the anti-tumor immunity. However, these macrophages can exert a double-sword edge also to promote tumor link RNA irinor. Irinor switch macrophages from tumor suppressing to a tumor promoting phenotype because it activates the NF-kappa B pathway and to produce a huge amount of TNF-alpha and also IL-6. And these cytokines promote tumor growth. Also, following antibody therapy, macrophages can be converted into an immunosuppressive phenotype because of antibody-dependent phagocytosis, ADCP. ADCP converts the macrophages into an immunosuppressive phenotype and to inhibit cytotoxicity of T cells and NK cells. So in this kind of macrophages, the inflammation actually is mediated by inflammasome. And inflammasome might upregulate the expression of immune checkpoints like PD-L1 or IDO from the macrophages. So these subsets of macrophages are highly immunosuppressive. So in summary, mechanisms impairing effector immune cell deployment include RGF1 that reduce anti-tumor T cell recruitment, and also a link RNA anchor to induce activation-induced cell death of tumor antigen-specific T cells. Also, CD55 expressed on tumor cells can suppress ICOS ligand expression on B cells and to inhibit T cell activation. CCLA18 that recruits naive T cells into the tumor and to convert them into Tregs, then to assist its Treg conversion in the tumor microenvironment. And the inflammatory microenvironment of the tumor, iRNA link RNA can balance the macrophages from immune stimulation to tumor promotion. Also, antibody treatment can convert macrophages into immunosuppressive phenotype by ADCP. Then how to reverse this kind of resistant mechanism? We can actually to knock out, for example, ANKIL expression in the CAR T cells or in the infiltration T cells of the tumor patients, and then to reduce their activation in new cell death to improve CAR T cytotoxicity. Also, adoptive transfer of this CAR T with ANKIL knockout can lead to more intensive CTL infiltration and tumor growth in the PDX. Also, we also screen for the blockers of RGS1 to improve T cell infiltration into the tumor. And also, generation of monoclonal antibody against CD55 can reactivate the T cells in the secondary lymphostructure in the tumor. In summary, the effector immune T cells deployment is actually influenced by the ecosystem of the tumor, not only by the microenvironment around the tumor, also by the host distant organs or a systemic regulatory systems, for example, like nervous system, endocrine system, and immune system can affect the effector immune cell deployment in the host. And EICD is actually tightly regulated by tumor ecosystem and to distinguish tumors from cold and to hot immune tumors. Take home messages for today is that we should precisely assess EICD in cancer patients. It is very important to exactly do immunotyping for the cancer. And also, balance of tumor inflammation can play a critical role in regulation of EICD. And further uncovering the underlying mechanism of immune escape will provide novel strategies to enhance effector immune cell deployment in cancer patients, and also individualized treatments to enhance effector immune cell deployment is promising strategy to effectively improve anti-tumor immunotherapy for cancer patients. Finally, I would like to acknowledge people in the lab who contribute to the work. Sicheng Su is a driving force in the lab in control of the tumor immunity part. And Chang Liu is department chair in our clinic. And also, we honor people who contribute to all those studies. And also, we would like to thank funding departments, NSFC, and Ministry of Sciences and Technology of China. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Song.
Hi, thank you.
Yeah, you have very succinctly shared with us the series of studies that have helped us understand better and the immunotherapy, specifically the subtypes of cancer-associated immune and mesenchymal cells, the new receptors for crucial cytokines, and then the new form of long non-coding RNAs that help us understand better the functioning and regulation of intracellular and intercellular signal transduction. I think in totality, these contributions provide new insights for therapeutic strategies and targeting tumor microenvironments, as well as immunotherapies for solid tumors. That's like you and your team have just made incredible contributions.
Thanks a lot.
We have time for a few questions.
Yep.
And I think the first question that we see is your concept of EICD. Is it applicable to all types of solid tumors?
Yes.
And then additionally, if you could also comment on the clinical significance for studies on EICD. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Kurasha. Sure. EICD is a concept could be applied to all subtypes of solid tumors, not only for breast cancer, but for like lung cancer, liver cancer, and pancreatic cancer. You can use EICD to define how the anti-tumor immunity in the patient, whether it's at the optimal stage or whether we should improve it. And the clinical significance on the studies of EICD, I think it's on two ways. First of all, we should use EICD to define whether a tumor is a cold one, is an immunocold tumor or immunohot tumor. Because usually we look at infiltration of lymphocytes or infiltration of immune cells in the tumor. That's not appropriate because in the infiltration lymphocytes, they have some regulatory T cells or Th2 cells, which are pro-tumor. We should look for those CTL, CD8 T cells, or Th1, CD4 T cells, which are tumor antigen specific and which are activated. And those are the cells that can kill tumor cells. On the other hand, we should also look at the activated NK cells or innate immune cells, which are actually contribute to tumoricidal effects. So EICD actually is an accurate concept for us to diagnose whether a tumor is a hot one or a cold one. And secondly, EICD, the studies of EICD might help us to identify number of checkpoints or targets that we can block for new immunotherapy strategies. So the clinical significance on studies of EICD on two ways, diagnosis and immunotherapy. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And congratulations again on winning the TWAS 2022 award in medical science. We will now move from the TWAS 22 Agricultural and Medical Science Awards to the winner of the 2021 TWAS Abdul Karim Award in Biology. For this, I call upon Chinaba Dabitwa. Congratulations, and we look forward to hearing more on your work in terms of inflammatory cytokine responses in health and disease. So, Dr. Dabitwa is an assistant professor of molecular microbiology in the chief of the Immunocore Laboratory at the University of Sciences, Techniques and Technologies of Bamako in Mali. She also received her D.Pharm degree from this university and then went on to obtain her MSc and PhD in molecular microbiology and immunology at Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, United States of America. So we'll hear first from Geneva on her work, and then we'll have time for a question or two. Congratulations, Geneva.
Hello everyone, my name is Geneva Dabitao. I would like to thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity to present our work on cytokine gene regulation. Today I will be presenting one of our projects on the role of genetic polymorphism in human IL-10 gene and susceptibility to infection. For those who may not know, interleukin 10, which I will name as IL-10 during this presentation, is an anti-inflammatory cytokine that is known to deactivate antigen-presenting cells. IL-10 is also known to inhibit the development of T cell subsets, namely TH1 and TH2 and TH17, which are the cells that confer immune protection, but also immunopathology. There is a strong genetic component to human IL-10 expression. Our studies have shown that heritability of IL-10 expression can be as high as 75% in twin studies. Also, there are single nucleotide polymorphism in non-coding region of the gene, which I will refer as SNPs. For example, when we zoom on the proximal promoter of human IL-10, we can find three SNPs at position -592, 819, and 1082. The three SNPs form two common haplotypes in human, namely ATA and GCC haplotypes. What is also interesting is that the ATA and GCC haplotype have been associated to low and high human IL-10 expression respectively. In addition to differential IL-10 expression levels, IL-10 SNPs haplotype have also been associated to many human diseases, from infectious diseases like HIV and hepatitis B, but also to autoimmune conditions like ulcerative colitis and Crohn's diseases. A few years ago, when I was a graduate student at Johns Hopkins University, we decided to focus on this research question by studying if the IL-10 SNP haplotypes are causal variants, which mean that if we were interested to determine whether they have functions. We hypothesized that human IL-10 promoter SNP haplotype ATA or GCC control human IL-10 expression, which in turn determine disease susceptibility. The prediction of this hypothesis was that SNPs mediate differential IL-10 levels, which in turn lead to differential disease outcomes. To address this hypothesis, we generated humanized IL-10 mice, which were made by using a bacterial artificial chromosome named BAC that carries a large cassette of human IL-10 genes, either ATA haplotype or GCC haplotype. Both IL-10 personalized mice here have the same genomic and length encoding region, but differ by their SNP and non-coding regions. When we made the mice, we decided to ask a first question. Do IL-10 promoter SNP haplotype influence IL-10 expression in CD4 T cells? So we isolate naive T cells from the spleen and we grew them in natural condition in the presence or absence of IL-27, which is known to induce IL-10 expression. And we did an ELISA assay to measure IL-10 production. As you can see here, we found low IL-10 expression production in the ATA mice. Meanwhile, the GCC mice produce a very high level of IL-10, confirming that ATA is a low producing haplotype and GCC is a high producing haplotype. The mouse gene that was also present in those mice, we did not see any difference between ATA and GCC, which confirmed that there is no feedback loop between mouse and human IL-10 between the same mouse. Then we were interested to determine if allele-specific human IL-10 expression mediates disease susceptibility. So we focus on the Leishmania model because IL-10 is known to have a pathogenic role during Leishmaniasis, because the lack of IL-10 expression in mice confer resistance to disease. So we took mice that have only the human IL-10 but no mouse IL-10, infect them with Leishmania duodenale, and we collect either both the liver and the spleen, and we assess parasite burden. So as expected, IL-10 knockout mice here in yellow are resistant to disease. Meanwhile, wild-type mice in green here develop persistent infection. You can see here that ATA mice, which carry the low IL-10 producing genotype, behave like, just like ALTEN-NOCHMAR mice. In contrast, with GCC mice have a significant high number of parasites in the liver. Similar data were also found in the spleen. This suggests that those haplotype confer differential IL-10 level, leading to differential disease outcome. We were quite happy with this data, but we decided to turn to an infection where the role of IL-10 is more complex, which is HIV. This is because the role of IL-10 in doing HIV seems paradoxical, as IL-10 has been shown to play both protective and pathogenic role. For example, IL-10 has been shown to limit HIV-associated immune activation, which is beneficial to the host as it slows disease progression. In contrast, IL-10 also inhibits proliferation of HIV-specific CD4 T cell, which can be harmful to the host as it promotes replication of the virus. However, the molecular mechanism driving this dual functionality of IL-10 during HIV remains to be clarified. So then we decided to perform a study in Mali, which is a large country in West Africa, by asking the question, do IL-10 haplotype are associated with HIV infection in Mali? This is because most of the study asking this question has been done in Caucasian population. But at that time, we did not have any information about the frequency of human IL-10 promoters in the Malian population. But we did ask, state the hypothesis that ATA low producer haplotype is a pathogenic haplotype that increases susceptibility to HIV infection. The prediction of that hypothesis is that ATA will be more frequent in HIV positive person. So the approach we took is to collect PBMCs of archive PBMC from 159 subjects, and we isolate the DNA and to perform a Tachman-based genotyping assay to determine the SNP haplotype. What we found that is that the majority of our study population was ATA, 71%, and non-ATA was also found at a lower rate, like ACC and GCC haplotype. Regarding the association between IL-10 haplotype and HIV, we categorize our study population based on homozygosity and heterozygosity carriers. As you can see here, those who are homozygote for ATA, HIV, found that HIV positive people were 20% compared to 70% in negative, which did not reach a statistical significance. We also did similar analysis by taking the SNPs individually, and similar results were found, which suggests that the three IL-10 SNP haplotype are not associated with HIV in Malian context. In summary, I have shown you that we can study cytokine gene regulation using humanized mouse model, which is a good system to control for the effect of environmental factor and genetic noise. We have also been able to establish the distribution of IL-10 promoter SNP in Mali, and we found that the ATA was the most predominant IL-10 haplotype, which can form the basis for future studies. However, we did not find any association between the promoter SNPs and the susceptibility to HIV infection in the Malian context. I would like to finish by thanking my institution, whose director is Professor Sedou Dimbia, and the entire team of the University Clinical Research Center in Mali, my thesis advisor at Hopkins, Dr. Brim, but also my K43 mentor, Professor Murphy at Northwestern University. I thank all my sponsors, specifically the World Academy of Science, for selecting me as the 2021 TWAS Abdul Karim Awardee. With that, I thank you all, and I am ready to take questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Geneva. And I think it is really impressive to see how you're bringing this cutting edge technologies and applying it to several health conditions in Mali. I think there's been a lot of attention on inflammatory cytokines, and I think your extension of the work to include trying to analyze and understand gender-based differences in disease susceptibility as well as the treatment outcomes highlights the importance of having women scientists, not only women scientists, but scientists in low middle income countries that are committed to taking on the local challenges and trying to unravel it, not compromising on excellence, but giving off the best. And I'm just impressed with the vast array of diseases you are tackling and trying to understand and enhance further. Many of these are regarded as neglected. I think in the face of COVID-19, we will see them moving even backwards. So I think this type of local leadership that you display and emulate, an amazing recipient of the Abdul Karim Award, is just further, I think, incentives and a significant role model for others in low middle income countries to emulate and follow. We have two questions. The one is around your humanized mouse model, and you shared with us its applications, particularly for HIV and leishmaniasis, and are there other disease conditions that you are using the model for? And then the second, I think oftentimes when we do research in one part of the world, in one type of population, and in this case, studies done in Caucasians, and then you repeating them in Malayan populations, how do you explain this lack of concordance? First, I want to underscore the importance of replicating these studies, but then, you know, how do we also explain differences that we see? Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Karesha. I am truly honored to meeting you virtually, but also to be presenting in such a high profile panel. Regarding the first question, we did tested our mouse model with other conditions, and because of lack of time, I could not go in depth. For example, we have used a septic shock model in mice by challenging mice with LPS, which is liposaccharide. And in this system, it is well established that IL-10 that is derived from macrophages will be protecting the mice from fatal outcome. And what we have found out is that there is no allele specific difference in terms of disease outcome when we challenge our mice with LPS, and which is quite interesting because it also suggests that allele specific IL-10 expression is also working with cell type specific expression. And the difference we are seeing is mostly based on IL-10 that is derived from CD4 T-cells. We have also tried the colitis model in which Helicobacter infection in IL-10 knockout mice lead to prolapsis, which is a mouse model of inflammatory bowel disease. And in that condition, we have found that our GCC mice were protected from prolapsis, which means that our data have been replicated in other disease model, but because of lack of time, I was not able to present those data. So regarding the second question about the lack of concordance, we were really surprised by this data, but as you have shared, there are heterogeneity between different regions and different populations that we will need to consider. And we think that It could be because of for the host, but also because of the virus. For example, HIV strains that are circulating in Europe and North Africa are different from those that are circulating in African context. And we know that some of the strains that circulate, for example, in South Africa, have a specific mutation in the transactivating gene, the TAT protein, that has been shown to induce low level of IL-10 expression in macrophages. We think that there is host pathogen interaction that could be explaining this difference, but also the inherent difference between people from different ancestry could also explain the discordance between our data and data found in Caucasian population. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Davitois. So we did start a little bit late, and we have a few minutes just to wrap up. And I just want to start by thanking the TWAS Secretariat for all their background work in coordinating this effort. And I think we all would love to have had this meeting face-to-face, but unfortunately with the ongoing COVID pandemic, it remains a challenge. This is about the closest we can get to face-to-face to appropriately recognize the scientific contributions made by Professors Daoxin, Luján, Song, and also Davitois, that is being recognized by TWAS, that this has all run so smoothly because of many people working behind the scenes to enable us to do this. I see we have Professor Morenzi with us, and I'm not sure if he wants to make any closing remarks. I'm not going to try and summarize complex and excellent science that we've heard. It's been an absolute pleasure to be part of the seminar and hear this amazing scientific endeavors over a vast range of topics that gives us a lot of hope in terms of food security, in terms of newer models for dealing with cancers, and dealing with long-standing parasitic infections, as well as hearing about new approaches to old problems. And I think in many low middle-income countries, we have so many unfinished epidemics and pandemics. And it's very heartwarming to see scientists from these countries so actively involved in cutting edge science, to see the collaborations and partnerships, to see the large teams gives us a lot of hope that the picture of lives and livelihoods that we see in low middle income countries and the quality of life can be changed. And we hope that we see rapid progress in attaining some of the goals that we've set ourselves, well articulated in the 2030 Sustainable Development Goal Framework. So thanks to TWAS for giving me the honor and privilege to chair the session. And I'm going to hand over to Morenzi for the last word.
Thank you, Kurasha, and thank you everybody really for this first seminar. We will continue other seminars. We hope you'll be able to attend the other seminars. And it was really very, very good to see a range of speakers, diversity, and Kurasha, we really thank you for starting this series of seminars. So I pass to Max for closing.
While Max comes on, I also want to thank the participants. I know it's different time zones we're in, and we really appreciate, I think, each of your participations. Max, over to you.
Thank you very much. Before I close, we would like to thank again both yourself and the winners for their amazing presentations.
Take care, stay well, everyone, and we look forward to future participations.
Yeah, a huge thank you to you, Professor Qureisha Abdul Karim, for your chair today, your chairing, and also on behalf of TWAS, we would like to express how grateful we are to your support, without which the TWAS Abdul Karim would have not been possible. So our gratitude is expressed to you. I also would like to congratulate again all winners for their amazing achievements, and the presentations were truly engaging, amazing science. Please remember that our second webinar, which will be in chemistry, will take place on the 14th of July, and you're all invited to attend. I thank all my colleagues present here for their wonderful work, and I wish you a good day. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thank you.